worship you. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you because of this great opportunity that you've given to us, our Father, that we may come and sit at your feet. We thank you that when Mary sat at the feet of Jesus Christ, her life changed. She carried the ability to carry Jesus, to carry the glory of God, to carry the power of God. She carried solution for mankind because she had been at the feet of Jesus. And today we come at the feet of Jesus. We come to receive the word of God. You said in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and through him all things were made, and without the word was not anything made that has been made. We come, our Father, because of the word of God, and we pray, Father, that it may cause the word of God to take the place in our lives. We worship you, we glorify you. Speak to us by the Holy Spirit. I pray, clothe me with your power and with your anointing, and clothe me with your wisdom and with your word, and give me the power to bring forth your word, Lord, with clarity and with anointing, in Jesus' name. And everybody saying amen. Hallelujah. God bless you so much, dear viewer. You're listening right now to Building Kingdom Wealth. We are talking about building wealth the kingdom way. This is really why we are coming to you at this moment of the evening. And I pray that God's going to use this moment to cause something to come upon your life that has never been there before. That God's going to open your eyes to see things the way you've never seen them before. We have been talking about what we call the race against poverty. And today, we're going to talk about how to deal with poverty. Because if you find poverty in your life, then you're going to have to deal with it. Poverty will not just disappear. It will not just sublime. You will have to confront it. You are going to have to fight it. Poverty, as I mentioned before, is like a wildfire that is pursuing you. Everywhere that you've seen wildfires, and I know there are nations where there's never been really danger of wildfires. When they break out, they are exterminated very quickly. But there are nations where wildfire takes about months. And in those nations, they understand the power of a wildfire. I just witnessed a couple of months ago when there was wildfire in Australia that burned for several months, and hundreds, even thousands of homes were decimated and destroyed by that wildfire. And that's exactly what poverty is a force of evil that is like the force of the wildfire. When it enters your house, it decimates it. When it comes to your children, it destroys and disables their potential, so that your children cannot be able to go to where they carry potential to go to, because you don't have the ability to develop your child, because poverty disables parenthood. And so poverty is a force of evil like the wildfire. And always, if you allow the wildfire to burn and stop, to burn unchecked, it can destroy anything in its way. And that is why you must rise up to the occasion and understand that if there's any sign of poverty in your life, that you must rise up and confront it and destroy its power. Poverty will not have mercy on you. You've got to rise up and fight it if you truly desire to come to the place of destiny fullness. And so the first thing that we saw in getting to fight poverty, to deal with poverty, is you must never build poverty. You must get your hands off everything that you've been doing to build poverty. You must stop every process that you've been involved in to build poverty. And number two, you must intentionally build wealth, because the force that gets to destroy the power of poverty is not prayer, and it is not any other thing. It is not debts. When you get to borrow so that you may consume, you need to understand that your problem is deeper It is not just the lack that you have right now. It is poverty. And debts don't sort out poverty. Poverty can only be sorted out by the wealth you've built. And number three, and this is what I want to talk about today. And I pray that you listen to me carefully. Do not dismiss me. I pray that you listen to me carefully. Because I want to touch something that touches your heart. Something that is really attracting political arguments in the church. And I want to dare confront it right now. So I pray that you listen to me carefully and get to receive the word of God, because I know that God's put it in my spirit. The third thing you got to do is you must break the curses of poverty. Now, that's why I've mentioned that delicate word that I've talked about, that it attracts politics in the church. And I'm going to talk about that, because I'm going to bring forth the scripture that people that talk against the possibility of curses being in the lives of people that are redeemed always use. Now we'll come there shortly. But the reality that I want to bring to your attention, beloved, is that a curse is a mysterious force of evil that is always associated with inexplicable negative or misfortunate happenings in somebody's life. I want to say that again. That's not complicated. I just want to say it again. That a curse is always a mysterious force of evil that is often associated with inexplicable negative or misfortunate happenings in people's lives. In other words, where there is a curse, you will always see negative and misfortunate happenings that many times people cannot explain. That somebody's making so much effort in the marketplace and trying to do everything they can to build wealth, and then a fire comes from nowhere and decimates everything that you've been doing. It is always just like that. So somebody's trying to reason it out. You can't reason it out. That you borrow a loan from a bank so that you may start a business, or that you may boost your business, and the loan runs into hundreds of thousands, and then suddenly somebody so key in your life begins to fall sick, and you go from one hospital to another hospital, and the person does not recover until the money you borrowed has been spent on the disease. That's when they die. And so you're left behind having to repay the debt that never caused anything in your life except trying to cure a disease. It is always mysterious happenings in your life that you cannot really explain through logical science. That's what a curse is. And the reality, beloved, is that there are so many people, even in the church, that are going through negative, inexplicable happenings that you can only associate with a mystery that people cannot explain. How do you explain an anointed servant of God, and every time that you marry, your wife has to be killed, and so one wife is killed through accident and another one is killed by thugs and shot dead and stuff like that? How do you explain such things? How do you explain negative things happening in the life of somebody that truly lives a holy life in the church and in the kingdom, and yet somebody outside of the church seems to just be experiencing good things in that area of life? That is really what we're talking about. So the reality is, those negative happenings are taking place in the church, and I gotta confront that. Now let me go to the politics that people bring up, especially in the grace age. And I want you to understand that I stand here by grace. I want you to understand that I live by grace. I want you to understand that I've been saved by grace. There's nothing that I give God to deserve to be called out of my father's household. I was the worst of the worst in that family, and God called me out of that home and saved my soul, not because I was better. There were those who were better in that family than I was, and God saved me. I've been saved by grace, sustained by grace. I live this far by grace. I've been turned into a pastor by grace, not by any cause or by any kind of education. It's by God's grace. And so I want you to understand that grace is something that you cannot do without in the kingdom of God. Salvation is by grace alone. So I wanted to get that. That's the foundation of things in the kingdom. You cannot do without grace. So when I talk about the grace age, please understand, I am not standing here to criticize grace. The problem is that we can actually use the grace age as a license to negate certain realities in the kingdom of God. That's where the problem comes in. And so in the days of grace dispensation and grace age, then we bring politics around curses in the church. And I want to show you the scripture that we pull out from, and that is in the book of Galatians chapter number 3. I want to walk with you through that before I get to talk to you about the possibility of curses of poverty, because we're going to deal with every one of them one step after another and break them. And I pray that you will be involved, you who are listening to me. In Galatians chapter number 3 and verse number 13 to 14, Paul the apostle pulls out this wisdom, and he says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse, for it is written, cursed is everyone that is hung on the tree. I want to say that word again. It says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse, for it is written, cursed is everyone that is hung on the tree. I want you to notice before I go any farther that Christ, it does not say there that Christ redeemed you from the curse of your grandfather. I want you to see that Paul is not saying that Christ has redeemed you from any other curse. It talks about the curse of the law by becoming a curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone that is hung on the tree. In fact, number 14, he goes on and he says, and he redeemed us so that the blessing promised to Abraham may come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. So the apostle says that if we were not redeemed from the curse of the law, the blessing God promised to Abraham cannot flow to the Gentiles. Hallelujah. Now let's break it down. If you go a little farther, I want to teach on the subject before I go any deeper. If you go a little farther, in verse number 17, Paul speaks this word. He says, what I mean, beloved, is that the law introduced 430 years later does not set aside the covenant previously established by God, and so do away with the promise. I'm going to say that again. It says, what I mean, beloved, is that the law introduced 430 years later does not set aside the covenant previously established by God, and so do away with the promise. In other words, Paul says that the law has been introduced 430 years after the promise. But stay with me in this. That after the promise was given to Abraham, the law was introduced 430 years later. And now this law is trying to tamper with the promise. So now the law has to be dealt with because it's trying to keep people from getting to inherit the promise. That's where the scripture is. Now verse number 19, the apostle goes on and he says this word. He says, what then is the purpose of the law? Then he says, the law was given because of transgressions. Now I want you to listen to me carefully. The apostle is speaking these words. He's saying that there is a promise, there is a blessing that God promised to Abraham that is supposed to flow to the descendants of Abraham in the future generation. But then the law is trying to stop the flow of that blessing. And so because of that, therefore, Christ has to redeem us from the law. Why would the Lord try to stand in the way of the blessing? Listen to me carefully. The reason is in the very purpose of the law that Paul talks about in verse number 19. He says, what then was the purpose of the law? He said, the law was introduced. The law was added. The law was added because of transgressions. In other words, the promise has already been given. And when God gave the promise of the blessing to Abraham, he was aware of man's sinfulness, but he still gave the promise. And the promise was intended to flow to the next generations. But then now, because of the transgressions, because of the sins of the people, God sees reason to introduce law. And so when the law is given by Moses, 430 years after the promise was given to Abraham, now the people suddenly begin to focus on the law because they hear in the law the echo of the demand for perfection. Because in verse number 10 of the same chapter 3, Paul said these words, that everyone who tries to be justified by the law is under a curse, because it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the law. In other words, the law says that if you do not fulfill all the law, you are under a curse. So suddenly, the law is demanding perfection because it's been given because of transgression. And so suddenly, you look at the law and you hear the law getting to mention your sin and make demand of perfection. And that is what eventually gets to rob people of the blessing that was earlier given to Abraham. Because now we begin to think, wait a minute, as long as I have not been perfect, as long as the law is condemning me and the law is testifying about me that I'm not perfect, I don't qualify for the promise that was given to my forefather Abraham. And so suddenly we focus on the law and trying everything we can to make sure that the law perfects us before we can truly turn to God by faith to receive the blessing he promised to Abraham. That's what makes the law become a curse. That suddenly it gets to rob us of the ability to trust God for the blessing that he promised to Abraham to flow in our lives without our perfection. That's what makes the law become a curse. So we're busy trying to perfect things. We're busy trying to make ourselves perfect to qualify to inherit the blessing that God had promised. That's what makes the law become a curse, because every time that we try to make ourselves perfect through the law before we can qualify to receive the blessing that God has promised, we fall short. So you fulfill one law and the second and the third and the fourth and the ninth, and you fail at the tenth. Then you start again. And so your life is frustrated every day trying to do everything you can to fulfill the law and become perfect before you can stand before a holy God and say, now I qualify for the blessing you promised. And we fall short over and over again in our own eyes. And so every one of us feels disqualified to reach out for the blessing that God promised. Why? Because the law has never made us perfect, and we have never been able to observe the law fully according to the word. And so because of that, therefore, the law becomes a curse. So how did Christ redeem us from the law? Watch this. If you look at the book of Romans chapter number 8, verse number 1 to 3, Paul speaks this word. He said, there's therefore now no condemnation to them that live, that are in Christ, that live not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For in Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life has set me free from the law of sin and death. Look at the next word. You say this word. For what the law was powerless to do, in that it was weakened by the sinful nature, God did by sending his son in the likeness of sinful man. Now watch this. What Paul is saying, if the law was unable to perfect us, the law could not perfect us, and we could not perfect ourselves trying to observe the law. And so we always felt like debtors who are disqualified for the promise all the time. So what the law could not do in our lives, God did. How did God do that? By sending his son. What did Jesus do? Matthew chapter number 5, verse number 17. This is what Jesus said. He said, do not think that I've come to abolish the law. He said, I've not come to abolish the law. The same law that stumbles you, I did not come to abolish it. I didn't come to remove it. But it goes on. It says, but to fulfill it. Hallelujah. So now, we have been struggling for years trying to fulfill the law so that we could qualify for the blessing. And we tried in vain. We tried to frustration. So Jesus comes and Jesus fulfills the law on our behalf and for us, so that in Christ Jesus we have fulfilled the law. So in Christ Jesus, God sees us as righteous. God sees us as perfect. And so because of that, therefore, Jesus has removed the law, the curse of the law that stood in the way, that kept us from receiving the blessing that was given to Abraham. I pray that you see that, beloved. That is what Paul talks about there when he says that Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. In other words, Jesus perfectly fulfilled the law on our behalf, so that now we have fulfilled the law and now qualify to receive the blessing that God promised to Abraham. And so Jesus redeemed us from the curse of the law. I pray that that makes sense to you. That's exactly what God is talking about in the Bible. It is the law, it's the curse of the law. The curse of the law. Hallelujah. Now, you need to understand, beloved, that I am standing here to tell you that Christ paid on the cross to redeem us from every evil that is a consequence of sin. And he paid to redeem us from sin and all the consequences. Please understand that. Understand that Christ paid to redeem us from every sin and the consequences of sin. I pray that that settles in your spirit. Hallelujah. Now, I want you to understand that the fact that Jesus paid to redeem us from sin and the consequences of sin does not mean that evil does not exist in the domain of man. Listen to me carefully. In the book of Genesis chapter number 2, verse number 17, the Bible said that God spoke to the man. He warned the man when the man was living in the Garden of Eden, and there was no evil, there was no sickness, there was no death, there was no power of darkness, there was no Satan, there was no demonic infestation, there was no evil of any kind. The Bible said that God warned the man, he said, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you must not eat, for when you eat of it, you will surely die. So God was telling the man, outside of your domain, there is a force of evil that is called death. And it will only come to your domain when you sin. When you do what I've forbidden you to do, then that evil is going to come to your realm. It's going to come to your domain, that evil called death. And Paul goes on in Romans chapter number 5 and verse number 12. Paul says, therefore, just as through one man, sin entered into the world. Sin came into the realm of man because man sinned. Said, just as through one man, sin came into the world. And the death through sin. In other words, death came into the world. It was outside of the world, but it came into the world. Now, I want you to understand that death is a force of evil. And death is the climax of all evil. All evil that humanity experiences has its climax in death. You struggle with curses only until you die. You struggle with sin only until you die. You struggle with sickness only until you die. You struggle with conflicts only until you die. The gossip in the church gets to wound you deeply in your soul only until you die. You struggle with depression only until you die. You struggle with poverty only until you die. Why? Because death is the climax of all evil. So watch this. When death comes into the realm of man, all the other evils come into the realm of man. So just as through one man sin entered into the world, and death through sin, and where death came, all other evils came in. And those evils include a curse. So I want to talk to us about curses. And I want to talk to us about curses of poverty. If you look in the scripture, immediately after man sinned, then suddenly God utters the word curse. God Almighty, the God who carries solution, the God who carries intent to redeem man, speaks to the man in the book of Genesis 3 and verse number 17 to 18. He said, cursed is the ground because of you. God told the man, because you listened to your wife and you ate of the fruit that I told you not to eat of, now cursed is the ground because of you. Now, listen to me carefully, beloved. God intended, when God created us and made us human beings, God intended that our living would be from the earth. Everything that we consume, everything that we feed on, everything that sustains the human life that we have comes from the earth. The car we drive comes from the earth. The cloth we wear from the earth. The food we eat is from the earth. The land we own is from the earth. The house we build is from the earth. The airplane is from the earth. Everything that we consume, everything that we feed on is from the earth. So God confronts the man and he says, now, because of you, cursed is the ground. He said, now the ground is cursed because of you. Look at the next word. He said, through painful toil, you will feed from it. And it will confront you with thorns and thistles. So God tells Adam, now the ground is cursed. Not because of anybody else, but because of you. Not because of Satan, because of you. Now when you try to plow the ground, plant your seed, the ground is going to produce thorns to confront you. Now it is possible if somebody else was present and that person did not have the kind of condition that Adam was in, it is possible that he would plant a seed and the ground would yield the crop. But when it comes to the same man that is called Adam, because of him, the ground is cursed. And it is possible, beloved, that you're doing work that is cursed because of you. That you are set in such a state of being that now because of you and because of the condition of your life, the ground is cursed. The work you are doing is cursed. Somebody else can do the same work and get so much product, but when you try it, you get thorns. You struggle every day of your life to get anything out of the same ground that when somebody else comes to and gets to plow it, he gets so much. But when you try it, you get thorns. Why? Because the ground is cursed because of you. Now God goes on, chapter number 4, verse number 10 to 14 to 12. The Bible says that Cain kills his brother, Abel. And God speaks to Cain. And God says in verse number 10, chapter number 4, verse number 10, Genesis. God tells him, listen, your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground. He says, you are now under a curse. God Almighty tells Cain, Cain, because of what you have done, you are now under a curse. It is not the ground that is cursed. It is you that is cursed. In the case of Adam, it was Adam, it was the ground that was cursed because of Adam. But now the curse is upon Cain. God says, you are now under a curse. Then he goes on and says, he says, whenever... And he said, and you will be driven from the ground. that opened his mouth and received your brother's blood from your hand. He says, anytime that you plant a seed in the ground, it will no longer yield its crop for you. Now, you will realize that if there was somebody else that was around, it is possible that the person would plow the same ground and the ground would yield for him. But for Cain, it cannot yield. Why? Because Cain's life is set up in such a way that he is now under a curse. So every time that Cain tries to plow the ground and plant a seed, the ground does not yield for him the same thing that the ground can yield for somebody else. I pray that you make sense of it. I want you to understand that those are words coming from the mouth of God Almighty. God himself speaking to man says you are now under a curse. And that is the principle, beloved. Now, if you go on chapter number 9 and verse number 25, you find a man that is called Noah. The Bible said that Noah came from the flood and he planted a vineyard and he made wine. And the Bible said that he drank it until he got a fall off dead. Lay there flood, uncovered everywhere. And his firstborn son looked at him. He's called Ham. He looked at his father and he began to laugh. And he went to talk to his younger brothers about his father's nakedness. When he went to his brothers, the brothers refused to see what he saw. And the scripture says that they took some cover and they walked backwards and they covered their father's nakedness. And the scripture says that when he woke up, Noah uttered a curse upon Canaan. Canaan is the son of Ham. And he spoke this word. He said, cursed be Canaan of all people. He said, the lowest of slaves will he be. Now, I want you to see, that's not the curse of the law. That is the curse of a father. That is the curse that has come from the office of Canaan's father. The office of Ham's father. The father has used his authority. He has used his office and he has spoken a curse upon his son. Now, that is a force that if you do not confront and get to deal with, it is possible it can affect you. Because though Jesus paid to redeem us from curses, you do not experience freedom from curses unless you address the curse. Why? Because everything that Christ paid for in the course of redeeming us is only appropriated into our lives by faith. And faith demands knowledge and action. I want to say that again. Everything that Christ paid for in the course of redemption is appropriated in your life by faith. And faith demands knowledge and action. That's why in the book of James chapter number 2, verse number 14, James says, brothers, if someone claims to have faith but has no action, has no works, can such faith save him? The answer is no. Verse number 17, it says, likewise, faith by itself, if not accompanied by action, is dead. That is the reality. Faith always demands knowledge and action. And so, Jesus Christ paid to redeem us from curses. But if you do not know the curse and you don't know how to get your freedom from it and you confront it, if you don't address it, then you lack the action of faith. And if you lack the action of faith, the curse may still work in your life. So I wanted to see that in that scripture of Genesis 9, you are seeing the curse of a father, not the curse of the law that we see in Galatians 3. The curse of a father that needs to be addressed. You go a little farther in the book of Joshua and chapter number 6. Verse number 26 to 27, you meet Joshua. The Bible said that Joshua, after he conquers Jericho, the great servant of God stands on the platform of Jericho and he speaks a curse. And the Bible said that he said, cursed be anyone who undertakes to rebuild this city, Jericho. He said, at the cost of his firstborn son will he lay the foundation, and at the cost of his lastborn son will he set up the gates. And 500 years pass. Joshua lives and dies. His body is buried. The bones are buried. Joshua is not alive. 500 years later, he's not alive. But the curse he spoke is still over Jericho. And the Bible says in the book of 1 Kings chapter number 16, verse number 34, that in the days of Ahab the king, a man called Hiel rose up to rebuild the city. And when he laid the foundation, his firstborn son died. And when he set up the gates, his lastborn son died. All according to the words of Joshua. Joshua is dead. Joshua did not come with the weapons to kill his children. It is the curse, the word that Joshua left over the city that destroyed Hiel's sons. It is the word Joshua left. That is not the curse of the law. That is a curse of a man in authority over Jericho that he left over Jericho. And the curse does not forbid people from walking across Jericho. The curse does not say, cursed is anyone who builds a house in Jericho. No. It just talks about anybody who undertakes to rebuild the city. So building a house is not prohibited. Marrying on the platform is not prohibited. Building a retreat is not prohibited. Building a road is not prohibited. Building the city is what is prohibited by that curse. And that is what attracts the destruction that came upon Hiel's house. I pray you get it, beloved. If Hiel understood that it is possible to deal with curses, he could have approached God and he could have known how to deal with God so that he would destroy the curse and get his freedom from it. But he did not know, because everything that God has paid for in redeeming mankind is appropriated in your life by faith, and faith demands knowledge and action. I pray you get it, beloved. I'm standing here to tell you that just like other forces of evil exist around man, so does a curse. Curses do exist. And if they're not addressed and dealt with, it is possible for curses to affect somebody. Let me go a little deeper, beloved. You realize that when Jesus paid on the cross, he redeemed mankind from sin. But the question, beloved, is how many people struggle under sin? You realize that Jesus paid to redeem us from eternal death, from hell itself. He paid on the cross to redeem us from the power of hell. He did. But how many people are in hell? How many souls are languishing in hell after Jesus has paid? Why? Because he paid to redeem us from sin and from hell. But then for us to experience it, it must be appropriated in our lives by faith. And faith demands knowledge and it demands action. Jesus Christ paid to redeem us from the power of sickness and disease. It doesn't matter what else you believe, beloved. God spoke to the Israelites over and over again and gave them a promise in the book of Exodus chapter number 23. He spoke to them verse number 24 to 25. He said, worship the Lord your God, and his blessing will be upon your food and your water. And then he said, and I will take away sickness from you. God said, I will take sickness away from you. And somebody can't believe right now for that sickness to cease in your body. God said, I will take away sickness from you. The book of Deuteronomy chapter number 7, verse number 15, he said, it will keep you free from every disease you knew in Egypt. And you can stand on that platform and you can believe God for it. The book of Isaiah 53, verse number 4 to 5, the Bible says that Jesus bore our infirmity upon his body on the cross, and by his stripes we were healed. And Peter echoes that in the book of 1 Peter chapter number 2 and verse number 24. He said, by the stripes of Jesus Christ we were healed. But the question is, how many people reel under sickness and disease in the church? That Jesus paid to redeem us from sickness and disease, but we still carry the diseases of our forefathers, and at times they kill us. Why? Because even though he redeemed us, we must appropriate the experience of freedom from the disease by faith. And faith demands knowledge and action. That's why when you look in the scripture, you find in the book of James, chapter number 5, verse number 13 to 14, verse number 14 to 15, James says, if any one of you is sick, let him call the elders of the church. Let them lay hands upon him and anoint him with oil. And the prayer made in faith will make the sick person well. James is talking about a saint in the church who is sick, and he says they must be laid hands on. Jesus paid to redeem us from sickness, and by his stripes we were healed, and yet there's still sickness that must be confronted. And in the same way, it is possible that he paid for the curse to redeem us from the curse, but it's possible that there's a curse on somebody that must be confronted. While you look at somebody in the book of Luke chapter number 16, and you find a man called Lazarus. The Bible talks about Lazarus. Jesus spoke about him. Lazarus was a poor man at the gate of a rich man. His skin was covered with sores. The Bible says that he died in that condition. Died of the sickness that Jesus paid to redeem him from. And yet Lazarus, if you look at the verses that ensue, was a saint going to heaven. Hallelujah. He paid to redeem us from death and the power of death. But how many saints die before their time? Jesus Christ died, and he paid with his death, paid with his life to redeem us from the power of death. But how many saints have been killed at 23 years of age? How many have died, left widow behind? How many saints have died, left orphans behind? How many people in the church have died? And you look in the background and you find this person has died. At the same time, his father died. And his father was not in the kingdom. And this guy has died at the same time. Jesus paid to redeem you from the power of death. And death still gets to cost on the family, even though somebody is in the church. Beloved, don't allow anybody to lie to you that all this is just automatic. Hallelujah. You must come to the place that you understand that whatever Jesus paid to redeem us from is appropriated in our lives by faith. And faith demands knowledge and action. That's why he destroyed Satan according to scripture. The Bible said that when Jesus died, he destroyed Satan. Hebrews chapter number 2, verse number 14 to 15. Said he shared in our humanity so that by his death he might destroy Satan. So he destroyed Satan by his death. But when you look at 1 Peter chapter number 5, Peter says in verse number 8, he said, therefore be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. And Peter says, resist him, standing firm in the faith. What is that? Action. Why do you resist him? Because Jesus has destroyed him. Because Jesus has already paid to redeem you from the power of Satan. And so now you can stand and address Satan. But if you don't address him, I got to tell you, he will devour you. That's why Paul said that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. The book of Ephesians chapter number 6 and verse number 12. Why? Because even though Jesus paid to redeem us from the power of Satan, we still have to rise up in faith and confront satanic forces. Bible said in the book of 1 John chapter number 3. Verse 8, that Jesus Christ destroyed the works of the devil. But the reality, beloved, how many saints in the church have the works of the devil experienced in their lives? How many saints are struggling right now? And what they're going through, everybody knows this is the work of the devil, not the work of God. How many saints are right now about to die, and the force of evil that is killing somebody before their time is clearly the work of the devil. The person has not come to the fulfillment of their years. They have not come to the fulfillment of the years that God gave them. They're dying prematurely. They're dying of a force that is clearly the work of the devil and their saints in the church. Why? Because everything that Jesus bought for us in the course of redemption is appropriated in our lives through faith. 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 And faith always demands knowledge and action. I'm speaking this intentionally because it's possible for you to hear contentions against the need to address causes of poverty. And that is true concerning poverty, beloved. The Bible says that God gives the power to make wealth. And how many saints go to the marketplace and struggle all their day? The Bible says that God raises the poor from the dust, the needy from the ash heap. How many people are still sitting in the dust of poverty in the church? The Bible says that Jesus, you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, in order that you through his poverty might become rich. How many saints are poor all their days in the church until they die? Why? Because everything that Jesus paid for our lives in the course of redeeming us, is appropriated in our lives by faith. And faith demands knowledge and action. And I need to rise here and submit to you, beloved, that that includes curses. Yes, he has paid and he has guaranteed freedom from curses. But there are forces that you must only experience freedom from through faith. And faith demands knowledge and action. That's why it's possible to be in church and you carry forces of a curse of poverty in your life. And I'm sure you know people who are hardworking in the marketplace, people that are hardworking employees, so devoted to their career, but they have nothing to show for it because everything they're trying to build is shattered by forces that nobody can explain. And the reason of a cause, there are curses of poverty. I'm going to talk about this much more deeply later. But there's a principle that I want to share with you. If you look in the book of Deuteronomy chapter number 28, in verse number 15, God was talking about the curse of the law, which Jesus had already paid to redeem us from, as I've explained. But he spoke these words. He said, "These curses will pursue you and overtake you." It shows us the pattern of the activities of the curse. Curses pursue you and overtake you. That talks about three stages of experiencing a curse. There's a time when the curse is present but just pursuing you. By design, a curse is supposed to stop you. But any curse that's pursuing you has no power to stop you. And there are so many people coming from homes where there are curses of poverty that are right now experiencing economic explosion in their lives. And they think they are free. But as long as there is a curse of poverty in that home, it is possible that it's just a short while before they begin to experience it. Because right now the curse is just pursuing. Then it gets to a place where the curse comes upon you. It catches up with you. And that's the moment that people begin to experience the curse. So suddenly, its force becomes experienced. And that's when you begin to see things getting negative. And you begin to experience negative patterns in your life. If it is married or curse, you are always in honeymoon the first years of your marriage. And you are the kind of person that was being praised by everybody in that home. The only person whose marriage seemed like they were working. Everybody else's marriage has broken. And then suddenly it catches up with you and begins to slow you down. And it's not long before your marriage is dead. Because curses pursue you. Catch up with you before stage number three overtake you. When a curse overtakes you, it goes ahead of you. Now it has the power to stop you. And that's why you find there are people that have always been so marketable. I was dealing with a precious man that has 3 degrees and a master's. It was the person that everybody was looking for in the marketplace. Everybody in the organizational settings, everybody was looking for him because he carried so much expertise. And he got to a place where all of the houses he built were sold. All of the lands were taken. The cars were taken. He would actually look for fare to borrow from somebody to get to the city center. And the reason is because he got to the place where the curse of poverty overtook him. And he got to the place where he would carry there his great purpose to organizations that used to love him and used to attract him and used to call him to seek his consultancy. And this time, nobody would consider his purpose. Why? Because the curse has gone ahead of you and has sat in that interview panel before you arrive and already picked somebody else before you come in. Let me tell you, beloved, curses are real. Curses are real. Curses of poverty are real. Marital curses are real. I don't have the time to talk about it. Marital curses are real. There are people right now that are reeling under it. They understand. Curses of barrenness are real. There is a pastor's wife right now struggling to get one child. One child. 10 years down the line after marriage. One child crying out, Lord, vindicate me. And you can't conceive once because there is a curse of barrenness that has never been addressed. Curses are real. You cannot toy with them. You just need to discover and address them. The same way that you've been given the power to address the enemy and trample him underfoot, you have the power to address and trample curses. But you must know them and you must get a deal with them for you to be free from curses. God bless you. I pray that that opens your eyes. Don't allow anybody to lie to you. Get to deal with things you need to fight so that you come to the place of destiny. You live once. You deserve the best. May you rise up in Jesus' name. And may God help you to come to the place where you have a passion to experience the best in life because you deserve it. Jesus already paid. It's already been handed to your lap if you are willing to receive it. May God bless you. All right, I want us to pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I thank you because of every soul that has been listening to this message. And I pray, eternal God, that you may open the eyes of your people and cause everybody to see that every evil must be addressed. Jesus has paid, and you've given us the power to address them. Lord, I pray that you will cause your people to rise up and acknowledge that curses of poverty do exist, and somebody must rise up to destroy them. In the name of Jesus Christ, you paid with your blood. We can walk in and experience what you bought for us. And I pray, Father, that nobody's going to reel under the curses of poverty from today. That we're going to get into our closet and we will address them and break their power in Jesus' mighty name. If you want to give to the Lord, I know that there are several people that are watching me, and you know you desire to give God because you want to partner with God in the course of building wealth in your life, and you want to be very intentional. If you want to do that right now, I want to pray with you as you give to the Lord of your tithes and your substances, whichever way that God's going to help you. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. And as your people are stretching their hands and reaching out to give to you, Father, that you will begin to tamper with every force of curses in their lives and begin to cause your people to experience a new dawn, a new era for the glory of your name. Open the heavens over our lives and grant us to experience the blessing of the living God. If you want to give your life to Christ, why don't you do that on this set today, wherever you are? Just say this prayer and commit your life to the Lord. God's going to help you. Say, Lord Jesus, I come to you. Acknowledge that I'm a sinner and I ask you to come into my life. Forgive me my sins. For today I commit my life to you. Come into my life, Lord Jesus, and save me. In Jesus' name. Said a simple prayer meant in the heart. It means everything because that's where rebirth takes place. God bless you so much. Kenny Afra is my name. I'm going to look forward to seeing you tomorrow. And we're going to see you also on Saturday and Sunday. God bless you so much. Amen.